Hello and welcome to Crux Investor. We caught up today with Dale Verran. He's the CEO at Fortune Bay Gold Corp, a TSX-V developer with assets in BC and Mexico, actually. We talked to him about the recent update in mineral resource. They've sent a drill to site. We talked to him about what they hope to be able to do with their step out program and the timing for their PFS. If you want our thoughts and opinions on the conversations, topics discussed, the company itself, and indeed the CEO, you can find that at cruxinvestor.com/club, where you can also find detailed company reports and analysis. There's commentary from experts from around the world on a variety of companies and commodities. We've got training courses on there to help you with your diligence process. We've done summaries of interviews, in fact, all of our interviews, to save you some time because we know you're busy. And most importantly, we've got a thriving community of investors on there sharing their thoughts and ideas with each other in a nice, friendly, and safe environment free from judgment, trolling, and abuse. So again, join them at cruxinvestor.com/club. I think you'll really like it. We'd love your feedback too. So give us a like, we appreciate it. Leave your thoughts below, get back to everyone. And if you want to see precisely what we talked about today with Dale, take a look in the description below. Dale, how are you?
I'm very good in yourself. Thanks, Matt.
Long time no see. Beginning of September 2020. I wasn't sure if you'd made it, but here you are.
It was a tough year for us all, but yeah, we're here and we're going strong.
You're fit and you're healthy and you're probably wise.
Yeah, I'm getting there.
Getting there. Good. I'm glad to hear it. So where are you hiding out? Kelowna, wasn't it?
I'm in British Columbia. I'm based in Kelowna. Yeah. Nice and early here for us. It's an early start.
Yeah, look, I appreciate that. We hadn't realized how early it was when we kind of set this up, but look, your shareholders will forgive you and thank you for it. So I appreciate it. And how are things in Kelowna? We like Kelowna. It's a pretty part of the world. Is it heating
beautiful,
up yet?
Yeah, beautiful spot. I mean, spring's arriving, but the good news is, you know, up north in Saskatchewan where we're busy, it's still nice and cold. So we're able to, keep our drilling program going there.
Yeah. Okay. Well, fantastic. We're going to hear about it. Well, look, why don't we kick off? We're going to have to, because it's been a while since we spoke.
Yeah.
August, right? September, beginning of September. We should give help people with a reminder of what it is that you are. So give us that 1 minute overview and I'll pick it up from there.
Yeah. So Fortune Bay Corp is a gold focused exploration and development company. We listed on the TSX-V under the symbol FOR and in Frankfurt under the symbol 5QN. And across the categories, we have about 3 million ounces of gold across our two projects in Saskatchewan and Mexico. And, you know, our near-term focus is advancing our Goldfields project in Saskatchewan, where we've recently completed a new mineral resource estimate for the project and just started a maiden drilling program.
Okay. Well, I always like to start with the outliers, just kind of be able to park them up and actually focus in on what you're focusing in on. Let's talk about Mexico. You've got, you know, circa a million ounces there. Just again, remind us what it is that project is.
Yeah, so in Mexico, we have, you know, across the categories, 1.7 million ounces of gold. It's down in southern Mexico, Chiapas state, and it's got the resource on it and then lots of exploration potential. You know, we really excited about that project. Although we focused at the moment on Goldfields, we see this as a significant asset for the company, both as a, you know, pipeline opportunity or something to do, you know, arrangement with a partner, the right partner. We took a deep dive on the project technically last year, and, you know, our new technical team really dug through the data and created new models for the project, and a very exciting asset. It's geologically just outstanding in terms of its setting. The magnetic data shows this deep, buried porphyritic intrusive, and that's given rise to the epithermal system at Capimento, which is the resource. There's a prospect on the property called Cerro Lomina, which is drilled by Kinross. That's a porphyry system. You know, exceptional results there in terms of drilling that was done. And then numerous other exploration targets on the property, you know, some of also a skarn type nature. So it's a really good geologic property. It does come with, you know, community challenges where one needs to get access with the local ejidos to work the project. It's been done successfully in the past. We know it can be done again, but it's obviously more difficult to operate there, especially in the COVID climate. So our immediate focus is on Goldfields in Saskatchewan.
Are you being restricted from working there, or are you choosing not to work there? Let's be clear.
We're choosing not to work there. You know, there is, We have a guy in Mexico who's worked with the communities there. He stays in touch with them. He's visited the project recently. We can definitely get down there if we need to, but obviously focusing in Saskatchewan makes a lot of sense for us because it's easier to operate. We have people in Saskatchewan, and Goldfields is a more advanced project.
Okay. And with a market cap of $30 million, and how much cash?
We have $3.7 million in cash.
Right, so you got to be focused. So how much did you pay for the Mexican asset? And how much is it costing you to maintain?
That was a predecessor company that took that project on back in the early 2000s, made the discovery, and it's worked. It stayed with the group of companies and eventually came into Fortune Bay when that was created. It's the holding costs on the property of just over 100,000 Canadian a year. That's mostly mineral title. And then we obviously have a core storage facility there, which we keep under lock and key, valuable resource of information for us.
Okay. And how much value of your $13 million do you think is being ascribed to that asset?
Tough to say. We're not covered by an analyst. But it is a significant part of our resource base and has a tremendous amount of exploration potential. So the market decides that, but we see it as an important asset for us.
I get that's important, but the reason I'd like you to have some sort of view, and you must do it at board level, some sort of view on it, because I'll ask you the same question about Goldfields in a second. So, is there some or none? I mean, realistically.
There's definitely some, you can do your, look at us on an EV per ounce basis and then, say, well, we're not really treating Ixhuatán as material. We focused on Goldfield. So it's definitely going to get discounted on that basis. But maybe you could look at it as a third Mexico, two thirds Goldfields, in that kind of region, maybe more at Ixhuatán. It has a slightly bigger resource, really hard to say.
But it's one of those things like it's a management team. You're going to go, oh, we've got to mitigate our risk profile. So country risk, two countries, great. Commodity risk, because I know it's kind of gold. Is it gold, silver down in Mexico?
Yeah, gold, silver. There's also copper in the porphyry system.
Okay, so you're mitigating risk across the board. So on paper, it's a sensible thing to do. But if you're not going to be able to get at it for a while, or have you considered other ways of monetizing it? Farm-ins, for example, is that part of it, or are you just going to wait?
No, absolutely. We see the benefit of getting that story moving in the shorter term. While we can't see ourselves doing that, given how we treat our capital, which is valuable to us, we're definitely looking at a potential partner there, someone who's got the operational, financial capabilities to actually go work that project and unlock the value that's on the project. So there's no doubt, Matt, we've been talking to people about the project, and given the asset it is and its geological setting and potential, there's certainly interest.
Okay, that's interesting. I'm taking notes. Maybe we'll talk about it afterwards. So let's get back to Goldfields, because that's the flagship, that's the focus, that's where the money, time, and attention is going to be. You mentioned a few things that you've done there. You've increased the mineral resource, or been doing a bit of work on the mineral resource there. So is that what you've been doing since September? Is that why we haven't seen you?
We have been very busy doing that. It's been a big job. I won't lie about that. The project has tremendous amount of historical data. We've got over 800 drill holes across these two deposits. The drilling data dates, some of it dates back to the 1930s, 40s. There's drilling in the 1980s, early 2000s. There's a substantial legacy of data. So, for us coming onto this project, we realized it needed something new. It needed to be re-looked at in the right way. And the real opportunity here, Matt, was that there was never a geological model for either of these deposits. It was, if you go back to the historical 2011 PFS, there were simple mineralized wireframes just capturing all the grade information, but no representation of the geology whatsoever. When we got boots on the ground last year, we realized these are orogenic gold deposits. They have a strong structural control. And if you're going to turn these things into real assets and get the most of them from an exploration point of view, you need to create proper geological models that best represent reality. And there's a lot of data. At both deposits, Box and Athona, there's outcrop. You can take structural measurements. There's trenching. There's a lot of historical underground data from the historical mining. There's core that's available. So we spent a significant amount of time, both in the field and office, understanding the controls on these deposits, the structural controls, the geology. And from the ground up, we built new models, geological models to start with, and then mineralization models. And those were the basis for this new mineral resource estimate, which we've now completed. And we're very satisfied with the results. We know this is a solid foundation we can move the project forward on. We know that any mining project, you need a good resource estimate. That's the, you know, the foundation for an asset that's going to really make it in the long term.
So what does that look like? Okay, you're really happy with this as a basis or a foundation for you? Because it's like when you speak to people off camera, you speak to CEOs and GOs and stuff, say, they know really quickly what it is that they've got. Then it's a case of putting together information to kind of talk to the market and prove what they've got, right? So,
yeah.
But that doesn't stop. People know, sometimes know it's a rubbish project, and but they keep working on it. Got to get the salaries paid, got to get raise some money, and they hope something happens. So when you say you're happy with it as a basis of a good foundation, what do you know? So talk to us about the actual new resource.
Well, I think, you know, one of the most important things for us is that, you know, we all know the ultimate judge of a resource estimate is when you go to mine it, is that amount of gold actually in the ground? Now, in our case, we have some historical production data. It dates back to the 1930s, 40s, but we have no reason to suggest it's incorrect. There's a lot of reports that all seem to be consistent. When we ultimately completed our models and ran this resource estimate, we then did a reconciliation to those mined out volumes, and it reconciled to within 1% without us running iterations to make it fit. It fit. And that just gave us the confidence this is the right model, and this is something that represents what's in the ground, and we can now move it forward. You know, and in terms of it, the project's a good project. I mean, if you go back to 2011, they did a PFS on the project, which was based on a resource that was of a similar size. It wasn't necessarily, didn't have the right models, but it produced positive economics, NPV of 144 million, IRR 19.6%. That was a Canadian gold price of $12.50 an ounce. And today, obviously, gold's come off a little bit recently, but we're still seeing Canadian gold price above 2,100. So it's still robust in that sense. And we now have the base to move it forward using this new model. Now, what the new model does is it tells us not necessarily the total amount of gold. It tells us that, but it tells us where that gold is and in what structures the higher grades are in. So what we can do, firstly, from an open pit mining perspective, we know where those grades are situated. We can better control the cutoff grade. We can do more selective open pit mining to improve economics further. And from an exploration point of view, you know, both deposits are open. With these new models, we have a control on where the higher grades are, what the structural orientations are, and we can now step out and chase those higher grades. That's going to allow us to potentially expand resources. It also gives us the opportunity for underground potential at both deposits where we see grades that we think would be amenable to underground mining.
Your story is really confusing to me in a way, because I'm not quite sure if I'm looking at a development company or an exploration company, because you know, you put out a resource, which is great. That should be really exciting news. But I'm looking at your share price, and that's tracking sideways, right? It's just tracking sideways, which I guess some people would claim as a win in this market, because some of the charts are, you know, doing a lot worse than that. But it also says to me, people don't understand what it is that you are. 30 million market cap. It's a development company. You've got a resource. You should be doing way more than this. You should be getting noticed. What's the problem?
Well, we had to get firstly from we're going down two paths here. You know, there's a project development path, and we are a developer. We're going down that path. The step one was getting a mineral resource estimate. You need a current 43-101 estimate to advance, and we wanted to do that properly, and I've explained that process. We're now in a position to advance to a pre-feasibility study based on that resource. But, you know, we're sitting with two deposits, and they both are open. The gold mineralization's open. So we definitely want to concurrently with our project development is continue to explore. We're going to keep marching down, doing mining studies. We're going to do scoping work, but we're going to concurrently do exploration at both deposits to realize their true potential. And we're going to be taking step outs to see if these resources can get bigger. Those can be brought into the project at a feasibility level and demonstrate that this project is even bigger and better than it was historically.
Right. Okay. So PFS next, which is great.
You know, we've got this mineral resource estimate. We need to do some internal scoping on that, look at the numbers, and then we'll make a decision on whether to advance to a PFS right away, or there may be a little bit of a hiatus if we decide to see how the exploration results are looking. But we have a resource that we can act on and advance to a pre-feasibility study, given that 85% of our resource is in the indicated category.
Right. But you know, if I'm sitting here looking at what the company's done 8 months since we last spoke, there's no real kind of pace to it. It feels like there's no pace to it. And I think the market would agree that, like I said, share prices move sideways. And can we expect to see more from you this year? Do you understand the importance of that?
Absolutely, Matt. You know, we've come to this process of getting familiar with this project with a substantial legacy of data, doing a new mineral resource estimate, putting the company together. You know, we only got going last year. You know, the team's in place, the resources in place. Now we're in a position to really get momentum in this market and move things forward, both from a project development point of view, where we'll be doing internal scoping toward a pre-feasibility study, and with an exploration program that's currently in progress. We've got drill rigs in the field. So it takes time to set up these companies and get our story moving, but now we're in a position where we really can deliver catalysts, and we're expecting to have a, you know, really busy year with our project development side, as well as an exploration program, both in the winter, which is currently in progress, plus in the summer.
It's kind of a difficult one, because again, you're sitting there with a resource, and this is your focus, and your money and time's being spent there. But so how many ounces? Like, remind me, how many ounces are we talking about? At what grades?
So in the indicated category, we've got 975,000, so just short of 1 million ounces indicated at a grade of 1.34 gram a ton. Right. And our main deposit, the box deposit, is a grade of 1.5 gram a ton. Good metallurgy, open pittable targets.
Right, and you've got to drill up there now, or just about to be. It's going to be more of the same, right? The orogenic stuff, it's more of the same. It's fairly homogenous typically, right? Unless you tell me different. So what you're doing is saying we want to take it from nearly 1 million ounces to X number. That's when we can start making some interesting decisions. So why any one drill?
One drill. Well, we've got some select targets at both these deposits. So we want to make sure we step out and test the concepts first before we deploy more drills on the project. We obviously want to look after the capital as well. So we've got some very select targets where we're chasing not these average grades of 1.5 gram a ton, but we got grades up to 18 grams a ton over several meters down below the box deposit. And we want to test these in these higher grade vein sets to see what sort of potential they have. We've seen the deposit, the grades tend to increase with depth, and the mineralized unit is much thicker. So we think there's a lot of potential down there. And the first phase is really just to test these targets on initial and somewhat conceptual basis. And once we have proof of that concept, we'll go in there with more rigs and start to delineate.
Right. So how does that work in practice? Because, you know, orogenic, people think it's low grade, it's bulk, it's open pit ideally, and you get the bonus of some of these high grade veins, thin high grade veins running throughout the pittable area. That's the best you can hope for, right? So how do you define what size of project you need to get to before you think I can go and raise money to actually move this through the scoping studies? I can get more interest from the marketplace, because 1 million ounces is the bare minimum, isn't it? You're kind of at that cusp.
Yeah, we're around, you know, 1 million ounces indicated. We've got, you know, 200,000 in inferred. So we're at that position where, you know, and these are open pittable targets. Remember, it's not just the technical that's the advantage of this project. It's also northern Saskatchewan. The infrastructure is good. We've got a power line to sites. We have a valid development permit granted in 2008 that is still valid today. So the project's had approved EIS. In other words, it's done its environmental screening. It's de-risked to a large degree. So there's some distinct advantages there, but we do feel that there's definitely exploration upside. And it's, of course, we're going to look at that to see how much bigger it can get. So we think, based on the existing resource and the the factors around the project, including the infrastructure, location, permitting, et cetera, we think it can move down the development path on its own with the existing resource. You know, we've seen that the positive economics from a 2011 study at a lower gold price, it's much higher now. We think it can move on its own, but we want to realize the full potential of this project. And there clearly is potential, which we tend to realize through some additional exploration drilling around these two deposits, which are open.
There's a few orogenic stories around your size, around you guys don't want to become miners, do you?
We're not miners. And, you know, I'll be open about that, Matt. You know, I'm a geologist. My background's in exploration. It's in development. You know, I've got a history working with Denison, also on the development side in Saskatchewan. So we see ourselves taking this project down the development path, de-risking it, showing it's a project that's going to move, and then looking to, partner up or look for a suitable company to take us out. Or, you know, companies do also evolve over time where needed. So there's a good project's going to create a lot of good favorable outcomes. And we're going to create that good project, and we've got the team in place to do that.
Okay. So back to my original question is, what size do you need to get this to? Because if that's the model, no one's looking at 1.2 million ounces combined. People are going to look at what, 3 million ounces, 5 million ounces. So I'm trying to work out the length of journey am I going to go on if I invest in your company.
Well, you've certainly seen mid-tier miners, you know, take out smaller companies, you know, around just over that $1 million ounce mark, where there's potential and exploration potential. And I think there's definitely an appetite for projects that don't have a high capex hurdle, which is our case, in favorable jurisdictions that are safe, that have precedence for mining, and that are, in our case, we have a valid development permit. That's a huge advantage. But, you know, we think we can make this project much bigger. If you look at Box and Athona, these two deposits, if you're talking about how big can these things get, I mean, they sit within the same synclinal structure. There's a possibility there's a connection to these deposits at depth. So, you know, it really could be a big system we're exploring here. But obviously, grade's important. You know, if we're going to go deeper, you've got to keep an eye on grade. There's no point drilling, you know, 1-2 gram a ton at depth. But we see the grades at both deposits at depth that could lead to also underground potential. So, of course, we want to realize that in addition to our open pit story, which is in the region where it's we believe it's got the legs to go in this market.
But again, I come back to the orogenic story. There's lots of orogenic stories all over the world. You know, you're in the sure. right part of the Canada for sure. These are big systems, and companies talk about, you know, how big the systems are. You've got to manage things carefully. You got $3.5 million today, 30 yep. million market cap. Going raising money is expensive, right? Shareholders don't want the dilution, et cetera, et cetera. So you've got to be smart with the way that you spend your money. So talk to me about how the $3.5 million gets spent.
Yeah, so we've got this drill program on the go at the moment. That's going to be about, you know, 1.7 million. So we're going to have about $2 million left after our phase one drilling program. And then we'll be looking at pre-feasibility study plus what we call a phase two drilling program, which will really be follow-up of that phase one drilling program. So we will need to raise some money for that. So we'll be looking, you know, toward the spring for a raise. It could be in the region of, you know, $4 million Canadian. But, you know, we're well funded now, and our last raise was in December when we raised $2 million. And, you know, we could have gone out for more money. We didn't. We're looking to minimize dilution and do things in a incremental, stepwise fashion to make sure, you know, we advance the project sensibly.
Okay.
And in a disciplined approach.
And the reason I'm pushing you on this is because I think it's really important for companies of a certain size and how they move forward in a way. Again, with this style of mineralization that you're looking at, it's kind of, don't take this the wrong way, it's kind of admin to me. It's about how you position the company in a sea of other companies saying the same thing and get that standout from retail investors, which is going to give you the liquidity which you need, right? So your plans are to do more communication this year? We're going to see more of you?
Absolutely. You know, we really only got reactivated last year as a company when I came on board. We built out the team. We got deeply familiar with our project. Goldfields got things moving. We're now in a position to move and start delivering on those catalysts we spoke about last year. And we've now, you know, increasing our visibility. We've working with an IR firm. We're getting our story out there. It's been very much under the radar, but now that we've got news, now that we've got traction on our project, the market can definitely expect more from us and to hear more from us.
Beautiful. Look, Dale, appreciate it. Nice catch up. I do want to see more of you. So you know what you're doing. You just need to tell us more often what you're doing. So congratulations on the new resource. That's good news indeed. Stay in touch. Let us know how you're getting on. I will definitely take that phone call when it's received.
Matt, I just want to leave you with the following thoughts. You know, Fortune Bay, we've been essentially under the radar for the last while. We're now getting traction as a company. We've recently completed a new mineral resource estimate for our Goldfields project. We're going to be looking to move that into a pre-feasibility study. Concurrent with that, we've started our exploration program. A phase one drilling program is currently underway on site. We're expecting assays in the coming weeks. We also have a project in Mexico where we're really excited about the geological potential that we're looking to advance as a pipeline asset or with a partner in the nearer term. So we're really excited about where we're going. Our company now has some significant traction and the market can expect to hear a lot more from us.